Hello everyone, my name is David Lee. I am an educator, a design thinker, and a lover of making videos about innovative teaching and learning. Throughout my career, I've been lucky enough to connect with numerous great educators. In February 2019, I was contacted by Connie Liu, who wanted to share with me her organization, Project Invent, where their mission is to empower high school students nationwide to go out into their communities and use design thinking to invent technologies that solve real-world problems. A program that David Kelly, the founder of Stanford's D School, called the one thing that needs to be happening in every high school. Within the 2 years since its launch, Project Invent has provided their design thinking curriculum to over 1,000 classrooms, with over 100 teachers who attended their week-long training, and 50 schools across 14 states who have been involved in the year-long program. I got the opportunity to chat with Connie to learn more about Project Invent and how it equips students with 21st century skills through the use of design thinking, and how it trains educators in improving their own practice. Make sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the notification bell icon to get notified on updates and videos that I post on this channel. So without further ado, here's the chat I had with Connie.
So I'm Connie, I'm the founder and executive director of Project Invent. We're a national nonprofit empowering students to invent technologies for social good. So students are identifying problems in their community and then building technology solutions. That's been everything from smart wallets to help the blind detect builder nominations to football helmets that can detect early signs of concussion. And it's always driven by what students are passionate about and then teaching them the skills so they are empowered to see that the problems that they see around them are things that they can affect change in. So we recruit teachers. We believe that teachers are the ones who are on the ground and understand the context of the student, so can be really responsive to how to best empower their youth. So teachers apply sometime in the winter. So we usually keep applications open from like January to May, where any teacher can apply to become a Project Invent Fellow. And a Project Invent Fellow means that they're engaging in this year-long process of, we're training them over the summer for a week in design thinking, engineering, and entrepreneurship, and how you use those as tools for empowerment. Then they start a Project Invent team at their school during the year. So around September time, and then they're running this year-long program with their students until May, when their students get to pitch to investors and tech executives. And usually we host that in Silicon Valley and New York City. And now obviously we do virtual as well.
That's really cool. What sparked all of this to happen? Was there something that a concern or a need that you found that made you create this organization?
Totally. I grew up my whole life going to public schools. So in that fashion, ended up in very traditional schools where it was focused very much on memorizing facts and bubbling in answers. And I had no problem with that growing up. And then it wasn't until I got to college where I studied mechanical engineering at MIT. And one of the first projects I got to work on was to help blind people be able to access text around them. So we're designing something called Finger Reader. It's a camera mounted on a ring to help blind people read on the go. So just like as you're a kid, when you trace under a line in a picture book to be able to like keep your place, they can use that same interaction, and their camera can see the words and then read it back out to them. I had no engineering experience going into this project, but just the idea of being able to impact someone's life and literally change it was enough motivation to learn the engineering to create something that meaningful. And that was when I realized how much of a difference there was in the learning I experienced for the 12 years before I was suddenly trusted to like come up with answers to real problems rather than problems with an answer in the back of a book. So got really passionate about education and really started thinking about how do we bring that finger reader experience that I had to every single student in the nation. And that was the spark for Project Invent.
Could you describe the growth? Because you started from not having that type of experience, but kind of thrown in there. And what did you learn? Like, what were the things that you learned?
Yeah. Going into that project, I didn't have any context about like how I would actually help someone. I actually found this journal entry from like a month before I started that project where I had written like, I'm not someone who can come up with creative ideas. I don't know how I'm going to like change the world. Even though impact was something that really mattered to me, it was never something like a skill I learned in school. Fast forward a few months, I get to work on Finger Reader, and then the skills that I end up learning, I later found out are called design thinking skills, of being able to identify a problem, sit face to face with someone and learn about their story, and then convert your empathy into meaningful ideas. And I think that's one of the most beautiful processes of the human brain, of being able to deeply understand and empathize with someone right in front of you, and then be able to convert that into something that can change the world. So design thinking became a huge part of my life and became a huge part of what I wanted to teach more students to adopt. And I think everyone always finds the like engineering skills of it very cool, of like, oh, you were able to create something where a camera was able to change an image into a voice. How cool is that? But I think in the grand context of things, like being able to have a solid motivation of like, I want to change these people's lives who I get to meet with every day and who are blind, and having those design thinking mindsets of being able to be resilient, knowing that failure is not the end, that you can come up with creative ideas and try them, were much, much more important at the end of the day than any engineering skills I learned in our very lasting. So it was both of those skills, but I think the design thinking skills really stood out as what will last. Yeah, I mean, there's definitely a lot out there, and I think it's not the concept of design thinking that's being criticized. I think it's how it's being implemented. Mm. I think like anytime something gets popularized, it gets like reduced to bite-sized ways to learn it. Yeah. So I think the criticism towards design thinking is very much towards like 1 hour one shots of design thinking, and then saying, okay, you're creative now. That's right. Not how something works. Just like you can't go to the gym once and suddenly be like have rock hard abs and just be in the most fit condition of your life. You yeah. need to be training that muscle. And it's the same thing with design thinking.
What is your strategy to, you know, your goal to try to implement these three pillars of engineering, design thinking, and entrepreneurship?
Yeah, that's interesting that you mention how you take the standards and then bring in design thinking into that. I feel like that really good for adoption, right? Because if a teacher already needs to use the standards, like why yep. not use it in a better way? Yeah. We actually took the opposite approach of we like purposefully don't look at standards, and then designed a year-long program of what the ideal form of like design mm-hmm. thinking, engineering, entrepreneurship would look like if there were no constraints. And then we rolled that out. And because we took that route, we often end up living in the elective or the after school space. But we believe that as we gain more traction and more schools are coming on board, and I think like our 1 to 50 school growth in the last 2 years is indicator of that, of as we gain more traction, we'll be able to create more examples of what good innovation looks like in schools. And then we'll hopefully be able to change the standards themselves through showing examples of what it looks like without constraints.
Could you elaborate more on what do you mean by this whole process could change standards, the way people look at or think about what standards are? Yeah.
Yeah, I look back to my high school experience and it hasn't changed that much when you look at my high school now, like decade later. Where it's very focused on getting the highest grade on a test and learning the answers to questions that have already been asked before and asked many, many times. So every single student knows what a mitochondria is. Every single student can, like, this is kind of like a elite example, but like, let's say do an integral by hand. But is that, I feel like the world is shifting in a way that it's less important to know those exact facts and more important to have mindsets where you're learning how to be resilient and learning how to be curious, and that's going to get you further than mm-hmm. you having a set of facts that you know. And I think traditional schools haven't really moved away from that yet and are still very standards focused in a way that it looks mostly at the facts level versus the mindsets level. You just don't know which like facts or skills you'll need in your ultimate like career or life, yeah. But you do know that no matter what you do, you're gonna need to be resilient to failure. You're gonna need to be able to have empathy and be able to work on a team well and communicate mm-hmm. with others well. Mm-hmm. Like there are a few core things that no matter what you do are gonna be important, but it doesn't look like that's the focus of current standards right now.
Yeah. Could you talk a little bit more about the training that you provide the teachers who are interested in your program?
Yeah, a big part of that training and why it's a week long is because for most teachers, they've never gone through their own invention experience before. So the point of the 4 days is that we have that teacher go through an accelerated version of the invention experience. So they're meeting Jimmy, who's blind and has worked with a lot of our teams, and learning about his challenges. They're designing an invention. They're getting a chance to build it over these 4 days so they can go through the same emotional highs and lows and the same insights that a student would, even if in an expedited fashion. Mm. So then when they go back to their classroom, they can pull back from their personal experience, and when, say, like, the kids aren't able to agree on one idea, or they're like taking criticism personally, the teacher can say like, oh, I felt like that on my team too, and then this is how we were able to deal with it. That's going to be really important for that buy-in. Something you said earlier that relates to this really well is that the teacher needs to be really bought in if they're going to execute out design thinking or like innovation in the right way rather than a small dose way, because it's a full like transformation in how you teach, and you're not going to get bought in unless you've felt that before.
Absolutely.
So a big part is getting them to feel it.
When you were talking about the 4 days, I just kind of thought to myself, what if students did that as well? Mm. And it opens up that idea of what if for 4 days, instead of random blocks during the day, what if you just yeah. kind of allocated 4 days to that process? And so you kind of yeah. live.
I think a lot of people talk about like 20% projects. And then what if you just like, instead of sprinkling that throughout the year, you just have mm-hmm. one concentrated time to do it.
Can you describe one of your favorite projects that you guys have designed and then have students try out?
Yeah, one of the favorite projects, well, we don't really create like projects for them to do. It's more like, here's the process for how you can identify your own problems that you okay. wanna. Yep, so it's less like plug and play projects, but one of the favorite projects that students have made is called Adapt Play. One of our teams in Washington was working with their classmate Jose, who has cerebral palsy. So he uses a wheelchair. He has trouble with like fine motor movements. So because he has mobility issues, the students went in and were like, oh, he probably wants something to help him move around better. After talking to him, and this is the empathy part, they realized like, oh, Jose actually does not care about the needing more help with mobility. He cares about playing Minecraft with all his friends, just like any other teenager. And because of his condition, he wasn't able to use a standard keyboard and mouse. So he spent the year designing a new keyboard and mouse interaction for him. So they did like a head-controlled hat to control a mouse. They did like these joysticks that were easier for him to use. So now he could play Minecraft with his friends. And then that team actually ended up getting recognized by Microsoft and getting invited to go to their headquarters in Washington and present to the Xbox team because
of that. Wow, that's so cool.
Yeah, it was so awesome to see their work recognized like that. And those doors don't open when you just get like a 100% on a test. People don't recognize you in the same way as you coming up with something innovative.
What are some of the knowledge and skills that were required? Maybe you can just kind of list some of the science, technology skills and knowledge that students were required to gain to actually complete that challenge.
Sure. I mean, all of them build a physical technology. So they're learning mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, and computer science through that. Wow. You can think of a physical technology as like any wearable you use, like a Fitbit. Those all count because they have a physical component and like electronics and code in it.
Yeah.
So it's pretty integrated to give them exposure to a lot of new engineering skills as well. Typically they're learning how to like 3D design and 3D print. They're learning how to use Arduino and build circuits and code in a new language. So all of those skills get wrapped up in this larger design thinking project.
Do you sit down with the students and generate the problems that they see in their lives or their families connected with or friends connected with? How do you have them generate the problems?
Yeah, we always have them choose something personally meaningful, and that sometimes ends up being something that they see around school. So that was very much a case for Adapt Play. They knew their classmate Jose had cerebral palsy. They had seen him going around in a wheelchair, so they were able to ask him. We've also had teams who contact local community centers, like the Vista Center for the Blind or the North Texas Center for Autism. They connect with local nonprofits to learn more about something that they might have been interested in or had a personal relationship with the problem. So it varies, but they're all looked to do that outreach to be able to meet the people who would be good for this.
That's really cool, because right now I'm working with this a fourth grade teacher, and basically the standard, it's kind of fit with biomimicry. So the students will use biomimicry to solve a problem. I'm going to have like at least 5 students who get stuck with the problem part. Do you recommend a specific strategy? What's your process?
We actually offer curriculum that's just free on our website, where we detail some of the activities that we recommend for students to do to start doing that internal reflection of what matters to me. So some of the activities that we usually recommend are like do a community walk, walk around your neighborhood for 15 minutes and write down every single problem you notice around you. So that's an example. Yeah, the community walk is a common one that we recommend. Walk around your neighborhood for 15 minutes, write down every problem you notice. We also do this like concept of ikigai, which is of like the intersection between what you love, what problems do you care about, what impact in the world you can have, what you're good at. And that's usually a good one for them to reflect. And then finally, we have them look at like existing problems, like the UN Sustainable Development Goals. Just looking at that graphic sometimes helps you think of what you're passionate about.
Wow, that's really cool. Those are 3 great options.
very actionable.
Totally.
We know really important for teachers who don't have that much time and just need something to use.
Now that you have implemented this project event organization for the last 3 years?
Two years.
Let's say a college or a university came to you and asked you for some recommendations. How would you revamp the whole, not the system, but maybe the instruction, the learning that happens at college and university? And you said you went to MIT, which I feel like are the leaders in that kind of thinking. What would you recommend if you were consulting?
The one school I love to look at as an example is Olin College of Engineering. I think they've done a great job of making a lot of their content project-based. And I think project-based is the way to go for all colleges and universities, of have students solving problems in the real world and with real world context, not just in theory. At least for me, I remember taking like my differential equations class, and I took it from the math department one time, and then I was taking a statics and mechanics class for my mechanical engineering major. And I struggled so much in the differential equations class, but then we were using differential equations in the other class, and I was like, oh, this makes so much more sense. I just needed the context for why I was learning it. And I feel like that could be so beneficial for a lot of topics, to just have the context for why is this important, and how can it be applied.
Wow, that's so cool. Yeah, provide the students with the context, and it will not only help them make sense of the things that they're learning, but it might even help them to think deeper.
Totally, yeah, and be more curious about it, and that's exactly what we want. Like, it's great for the students to be able to learn the facts and figures, but having them spark a curiosity for them to dig deeper on their own should be the major goal of what we're trying to do with classes. I mean, every project that we have is technology for social good. We make that part very clear, that it has to be for social good, and they have to be thinking about problems around them. I would say that, at least from what I've seen, every high school student that I talk to usually wants to do some sort of impact career. So I hear a lot of the times, they want to be doctors or teachers or firefighters. They want to be the people who have impacted their lives the most. Mm-hmm. And then for some reason, when I got to college, everyone suddenly wanted to be consultants and bankers. and there is this huge like change in what people wanted to be. And I think a lot of that is related to not being exposed to what it would actually look like to make impact. And being able to expose students to thinking about hard, complex problems around them and give them the confidence that they can actually do something about it, I think can unlock a lot of young people to pursue impactful lives and careers, because they see themselves as change makers. And that's something that outweighs the kind of fear of exposing a kid too early to kind of like social ills. I think it's really valuable for them to get exposed.
Yeah, and it sounds like the work that you guys are doing, it's basically showing they have the ability to bring positive change to that kind of sad, gloomy situation.
Exactly. And then they don't need to see it as sad and gloomy and hopeless anymore. They can think of it as, oh, this is something that might be a challenge right now, but I see it as an opportunity, as something we can innovate on.
Is it kind of showing students that you can help people, but then also make a career and make money out of it? Is that?
Yeah, totally. I mean, we bring in some of the top venture capitalists, investors, and tech executives to be the judges of our competitions. Mm-hmm. And I think that is huge for students to see that, like, some of the richest people of the world are looking at the projects you're making and are able to see all the valuable skills you're gaining from this. So seeing that their commitment to social good was able to give them like that sort of platform, I think is really important.
Did you think about developing culture when you were creating this organization? Do you think about culture when you are meeting with the students to implement these challenges, I guess? How important is culture to project?
Yeah, I mean, it's our biggest focus of creating a classroom culture that facilitates this type of learning. If you take a standard classroom where a teacher is standing at the front and tell them to do the same project invent project, the students are not going to do as well, because there's still this hierarchy. Like the students aren't able to like think of each other as teammates. They think of each other as competitors. There's a lot of problems with, or I guess like a lot of changes that we advocate for in order to create a classroom culture. So a big part of our teacher training is about teaching 6 teacher practices that result in better classroom culture for this type of learning. So that's things like being comfortable with being a co-learner and learning right alongside your students, not having the answer, creating a culture where failure is okay and even celebrated, being able to not follow the lesson plan that you have and leave room for exploration rather than following it by the book, and being responsive to student needs. Like, all of those are mindsets and practices that we teach to teachers because they're all cultural values that we know are important for success in this type of learning.
So how can they learn, how can teachers learn more about Project Invent?
Yeah, so they can go on projectinvent.org, where we keep all of our free curriculum, our ways to apply for our fellowship, and a ton of additional resources for learning and integrating more design thinking, engineering, and entrepreneurship into their teaching. There's a lot of ways to get involved. We think about it in like three tiers. One of them is download the free curriculum that you can use however you want. It's the lowest commitment. You just put in your email. You can attend a free week-long training. So we offer free teacher trainings with our partnership with Infosys Pathfinders twice a year. So that's something any teacher, especially public school teachers, can attend for free. So that's a cool opportunity for teachers who want to get involved. And the final one is our fellowship. And that one's only open to high school teachers and is a year-long engagement. So it starts with a week of training, but extends to you're running a year-long program with your students. You're attending additional workshops as a teacher to build your teacher practices. And your students are presenting at our demo day to investors and tech executives. So those are the, I think of it as like small, medium, large ways to engage with Project Invent. And I think all of them are meant to meet a teacher wherever they're at.
Thank you so much for watching. Thank you to Connie for spending some time with me to chat about Project Invent. If you would like to learn more about Project Invent, learn about the projects they've developed, their design thinking curriculum, and even about their workshops and training, please check out their website at projectinvent.org. If you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, and share this video if you have educator friends who would be interested in this topic. Until next time, stay perpetually in beta, and I'll see you on the next one. Peace.